On March 14th, the US EPA proposed the first ever national drinking water standards for PFAS. To learn more, I talked with Ian Ross, who's one of the world's most accomplished PFAS experts. He explained why EPA used a hazard index, the implications on treatment technology, and what the latest research is telling us. Check it out.
So the levels that have been announced in the last few weeks are pretty low. It's a 4 ppt or 4 nanogram per liter target for PFOS and PFOA individually as a compliance target. But there's also an MCLG, which is a goal of 0 nanograms per liter for those two molecules individually. And then there's a goal, so not a compliance target, for the other four, which comprise PFNA, PFHXS, GenX, and PFBS. And they're sort of bracketed together under a hazard index, hazard quotient, which means they all have internally their own individual targets, but you can also sum them up under those targets. To my mind, makes a start to regulation of PFAS in waters, but we have to take into account the whole family of PFAS. There are so many more molecules out there, and we have an emerging understanding of their toxicology. Some PFAS, like the C2 analog of PFOA, like with two carbons in it, that is at a far higher concentration in rainwater. It comprises 90% of the PFAS in US rainwater and was 98% of the PFAS mass in German drinking water. So there are many more PFAS out there that I think we will need to focus regulations on in the future. And this, from my mind, is just a start.
Why do you think EPA is applying this hazard index approach? Do you think it's a good idea? And where have you seen this applied elsewhere?
I think it's a great approach. And it's been used in Germany back in 2017 by Bavarian regulators. And it brings a summation under one umbrella that you can actually have individual targets within that summation. So I think it's a superior approach to what we're seeing has been proposed in Canada, which is a sum of 29 PFAS under a 30 nanogram per liter target. Or in Europe, it's a sum of 20 different PFAS under one target of 100 nanograms per liter. So it allows for individual toxicologies to be applied, especially with when you've got some of these short chains where drinking water standards are often in the ppb range. Putting a sum together and saying they all have to be below 100 nanograms per liter can be perceived to be overly conservative in some ways.
What are the technology implications of these very low limits in terms of drinking water treatment?
So the lower limits, like the 4 ppt limit, it's going to mean you can potentially add additional sorbent media to polish, I think, to get lower. It's achievable. It just potentially means more media, a longer empty bed contact time, and just being able to turn media over when it starts to exhaust. You normally have a lead and a lag vessel, just keeping an eye on that. So I think mainly it's achievable. It just may require additional engineering and additional vessels that can be used to remove these PFAS from water.
Do you see certain drinking water treatment technologies becoming more favored or less favored as a result of this draft regulation?
To an extent, I think the issue is now we've got what is termed a short chain PFAS that's being regulated, but that is PFBS, and also GenX HFPO is not really classed as being long chain. And by long and short chain, we normally mean, are they significantly bioaccumulative in organisms? That's the definition. But the knock-on effect is that activated carbon is not that effective on short chain removal, whereas things like ion exchange resins are. And given the vast mass of differing PFAS out there, I think it's potentially going to, in the future, favor our reverse osmosis, nanofiltration, or methods that are more comprehensive at removing multiple other PFAS from water.
If you're enjoying this video and want to see more conversations with the brightest minds in the environment and infrastructure, please like and subscribe. And if you're interested in learning more about the sources of PFAS and how they get into the environment and drinking water, Ian recently authored a technical bulletin that breaks it all down in detail. To learn more, click the link below or go to cdmsmith.com/PFAS. All right, let's get back to Ian. So clearly, research will be key to developing new methods to treat for and to ultimately destroy PFAS. What research efforts are you most fascinated by, are you most excited about happening in the industry?
There is so much happening on destruction, especially. It's looking like various forms of plasma are looking positive. We're seeing the potential to create these species called hydrated electrons, which can also break down PFAS in solution. And they could be engineered to be effective. Certainly thermal techniques, we're seeing supercritical water, you know, 374 degrees C and about 200 bar pressure as working effectively. And there's some techniques which are using lower temperatures and pressures, but raising the pH, hydrothermal alkali. So I think these are all really exciting technologies that are getting to be field ready. But from a research perspective, we're seeing sonication or sonolysis, high frequency ultrasound, working really effectively on PFAS. It's just scaling them up and reactor design. We're seeing ball milling as potentially being appropriate, and the same thing there is scaling them up and seeing where that can be effective. That usually needs a dry matrix, like a dry soil or some kind of solid for it to be effective on. So the challenge of PFAS has really opened up the innovators. We're seeing so many potential solutions here. It's completely changed over the last 6-7 years, where we're now seeing really viable solutions that are going to be commercially available for destruction of PFAS on site. I think they're ready to go over the next few years. There'll be a huge number of pilots and full-scale systems using innovative technologies to destroy PFAS.
Well, it's a massive challenge, and a lot of brilliant minds are working on it, including yourself. And I'm sure we'll be talking more about this soon. But Ian, thank you so much for being here with me today.
Okay, thank you.